God Murray's T50, or Type 50, is set out to finally get closure on a mission the McLaren F1 came close to accomplishing. And that is to be what God Murray sees as the ultimate supercar. When the F1 was released, it set new standards, not just of performance figures or how special it was, but a recalibration of how people think or would imagine of what an ultimate supercar would be. Dreamers then had a new challenge. One can argue that similar excitement was had when Piëch of Volkswagen set out to build a 1,000-horsepower car that could be daily driven with ease in the Bugatti Veyron. Even though they both have ultimate in mind, the two are very different. Some even accuse the Veyron of being non-engaging, where the complete opposite can be said of the McLaren F1. Not all targets were met with the McLaren F1, although some were surpassed. The 6.1-litre BMW engine, for example, was heavier than what they wanted for the McLaren F1, but BMW made up for it by producing 623 horsepower instead of the 550 target. McLaren F1's dry weight target was to be around 1,000 kilograms, where the T50 is at 986, a full 150 kilograms lighter than the F1's 1,136 kilograms. Another area the McLaren F1 was off mark. Yet, even until today, nearly three decades on, it is still one of the quickest naturally aspirated road cars ever and still holds the record for being the fastest ever naturally aspirated road car. Those who have driven the F1 say it is one of the best experiences in a supercar, the ultimate experience, the very essence the T50 is set out to surpass. The idea is to amplify whatever makes driving the McLaren F1 thrilling. So how committed is this whole program? How far is Gordon Murray going to take us this time around? Well, the most extreme bit is certainly the engine. Murray said the engine is the heart and soul of any supercar, so this is no surprise. Even from the earliest phase of conceptualizing the F1 by the late 80s, Murray would not work with anything other than a naturally aspirated V12 engine when it comes to supercars. This is carried over to the T50, but with a much more extreme approach. This time around, they've created a V12 racing engine for a road car. This statement may be excessive, but here is why. The engine that comes closest to the T50 is not even from any road car, but from a Formula 1-derived purebred endurance racing car. The engine is called an F310E by Ferrari, used on the 333 SP racing car. Here are the similarities between the GMA Cosworth T50 and Ferrari's F310E. Both engines are 4 litres, although Gordon Murray describes the T50 unit as a 3.9-litre engine. Maybe there's a historical twist to this. Identical, the 65-degree V-angle, V12, for both engines, and exactly the same peak torque RPM, and that is at 9,000 RPM. They both produce around 650 horsepower, the former at 11,500 RPM, and the latter at 11,000 RPM. The T50 motor has a slight edge in torque, producing 467 Nm to the Ferrari's 447. The only major difference between the two is that the Ferrari unit has 5 valves per cylinder to the Cosworth T50's 4. So it certainly makes a case for itself when made out of being a race engine. Thank you. Racing engines normally have a narrow operating window when compared to an engine designed for a road car. Outside this window, it would be difficult to modulate its speed. This is because racing engines are not refined and is designed for maximum performance, so it would be tuned in extremes. That lower operating range is simply put aside. So the trick here is torque curve. Cosworth, even with those extreme numbers, managed to achieve this with the T50. They got the engine to deliver 71% of its peak torque, starting as low as 2500 RPM, which is normal for a naturally aspirated road car, but surprising for an engine that matches a race spec engine. Maybe they secretly in the crossover pattern exhaust extractors. It may hint at some very clever firing order on the engine that would lead to sharing return intake pulses between intake tracks. This can also be seen on the Aston Martin Valkyrie's unit. Maybe this is also why they disregarded using individual throttle bodies, so the resonance between ports can still be shared at small throttle openings. It has been done decades ago by the Americans with their so-called special high-performance inlet manifolds, but only recently on individual intake track. Renault Sport did this with their V10 Formula 1 engine. They changed the firing order, realigning the intake timing to work with each other, sacrificing an increase in engine vibrations. The engine then was known for having an edge in the mid-range. Adding to this, the GMA Cosworth T50 has variable intake and exhaust timing. For the ultimate driving experience, the V12 engine was chosen. In an interview, Gordon Ray says, from day one, it has to be a V12 and normally aspirated. Dossier provided writes that the V12 was chosen for that character sound it produces and power potential, something the V12 engine is known for. In other interviews, Murray mentions the Ferrari Colombo designed V12 engines to Lamborghini's Miura. The Lamborghini Miura is known as the first supercar. Its SV Superveloce has a remarkable near 100 horsepower per litre, naturally aspirated engine back in the early 70s. 4 litres producing 380 horsepower. Known high performance engines on road cars of comparable era, such as the Ford Escort RS1600 that uses Cosworth cylinder heads, produced 115 horsepower, and that is 71 horsepower per litre. On a 1.6-litre engine. A Porsche Carrera RS2.7 produced 210 horsepower, 77.77 horsepower per litre. Next, and probably the rest, is an augmentation of the McLaren F1's layout, its identity. The McLaren F1's central driving position and use of carbon fibre is carried over and improved. The central driving position offers similar experience to a single-seater race car, something that other supercars can't provide. For the perfectionist, it is also perfectly symmetrical and offers a symmetrical view. It also inherently won't raise or lower a driver with left or right lateral forces. The platform Murray created with the F1, his hallmark, and now the T50, has a resemblance to a prototype Ferrari back in the 60s, the Ferrari 365P Berlinetta. It also has a leading 1+2 central driving position and a mid-rear-mounted V12 engine. The biggest difference, of course, is that Murray's idea focuses on the challenges of packaging three occupants comparable to a two-seater, minimizing the width of a car's canopy design, where all three-seater-wide designs prior have them too wide. The Lamborghini Miura was originally planned as a three-seater as well, an interesting coincidence. Murray had already penned this idea since 1969. A difficulty in the central driving position is entering and exiting the command chair. The two carbon fiber beams that were on the F1 has now been removed to improve this. Chassis-wise, this is the biggest difference between the two. And we get to aerodynamics. The T50's rear has a notably large fan, unlike any other supercar. This fan was earlier thought to center around downforce, but it actually does much more than that. Its settings go from assisting in producing maximum downforce to producing thrust and reduce coefficient drag. Its diffuser is actually designed to purposely stall, then is routed to the fan to reattach airflow on the diffuser, and there it gets a 70% increase in downforce in high downforce mode. In low drag, low downforce mode, the diffuser is stalled, only extracting 30% downforce from its full potential. But stalling it would also mean there is less drag, while the fan is used to reduce turbulence and drag in the rear's base suction. If you take these two fundamentals, add the variable aerofoil, and the fact that the fan only produces 15 kilos of maximum thrust, the drag to downforce ratio is much more significant than merely observing from the fan's performance. Adding to this, the fan may produce much more downforce in influencing aerodynamic sections, which it is designed to do. Given the meticulous attention to detail and describing the central driving position as perfect, is this supposed to be the ultimate supercar, or is it the perfect supercar or a fusion of the two, using one to achieve the other? Having repeatedly mentioned words like haptics when describing switches that would go onto a car, getting a switch specialist aviation company to make sure that there is absolutely zero free play on the switch's spindle and for them to be perfectly weighed for feel, gives the impression that everything about the T50 must be absolutely perfect. Another question is, with Gordon Murray being adamant to have an engine targeted to have the quickest response upon throttle input of any car, will that large analog RPM meter be able to remain accurate? This comes from that Toyota Lexus stated that the LFA supercar had to use digital imagery for the RPM meter because the LFA engine response was too quick for an analog system to respond accurately. With its quickest engine response, it would be interesting to see how GMA would be put to a more difficult task in addressing this issue that the LFA had. Not only is the GMA cost of T50 engine quicker in response to the LFA, but also it would rev to 12,100 RPM to the LFA's 9,000 RPM. When GMA revealed them testing the engine, the exhaust system design also shows something that may be extreme. 3, 2, 1. The system is seen to have an option to completely bypass the silencers. This means that the T50 would have a completely straight pipe exhaust option. Wonder if this is specifically for the T50S, as drawing on the T50S does show the exact same design. Having an open exhaust on a road car that has a V12 engine revving to 12,100 RPM just makes that reveal date in 2022 seems too far away. Looks is subjective, of course, but to describe the T50 styling is control. The contours, form, shape and lines is all controlled in the utmost sophisticated manner and completely ignore any sort of supercar or design trend. They've darked out all the technical areas, such as the lower front intake and that busy rear section where all the ventilation is, diffuser and fan. What's also very interesting about the styling is it looks like they purposely blacked out the roof structure to add depth to the car styling by bringing out the interior.